to all of you besides the food. You can see a display of bumper gift here. All these are yours. But we will give at the end of the session, after the last speaker delivers his talk. So if I can see many empty seats, so if your friends have gone out, gone to the restroom or gone to the lunch, call them, SMS them, WhatsApp them to come here, because after the last lecture we are going to have plenty of bumper prizes. Besides this, we will have prizes from the Eton stall. They are going to distribute Apple AirPods. And as our esteemed speaker Deepak Dabaliya announced, that those who want to attend his lecture can fill up the form here. Registration is absolutely free if you register today. So all this will be announced at the end of the show. So let's move for the last talk of the conference.
Yes, moving forward, I think I will call on stage the moderation for our next lecture, Dr. Sanjay Wani sir. Please come on the dais.
And recently, friends, Tejal, we have heard that this super hyped Zumba classes that apparently everyone seems to be joining have the power to cure arthritis and may even magically fix the torn muscle. I mean, that's little far-fetched. I suppose you never know. Let's call on our speaker, Dr. Prashant Chatalia, the consultant rheumatologist on the dais, that so that he can debunk these theories. But sir, before you start your talk, the last question for our audience related to your subject, the question for you is, besides vitamin D, which supplements help aching joints? Which supplement help aching joints? So stand up and pass the mic.
Yes. 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 You are right. This is one.
One. Sir,
ma'am there. Trivedi ma'am. Yes, yes.
Vitamin C.
Glucosamine, she said.
Yes.
Vitamin C.
Adenoid.
Calcium.
Zinc.
Okay, who said glucosamine? Madam, come here. Who said chondroitin? Sir, come here.
Collagen.
The correct answer is glucosamine, chondroitin. Besides that, omega 3 and green tea are also supplements which help aching joints. Glucosamine helps keep the cartilage in joints healthy and may even be an anti-inflammatory effect. Congratulations to the winners at least. To hand over the prize, sir, I would request Dr. Kajal Bhanuswamy and Dr. Alpa Mehta to hand over the prize. The first prize sponsored by Royal Printers on behalf of PME.
A round of applause.
Dr. Alpa Mehta. Madam, sir.
Can I say anything else?
No. Our tagline.
आसमान की कोई सीमा नहीं सिद्धू आसमान की कोई सीमा नहीं धरती का कोई मोल नहीं माँ से कोई प्यारा नहीं और बीएमसी जैसा कहीं भाईचारा नहीं तो बता दो
इंडीड ब्रदरहुड बीएमसी इज ब्रदरहुड इज भाईचारा सर बट आवर टैगलाइन
बीएमसी मेरी जान है और मेडिमेट उसकी पहचान है
यस मैम
PMP मेरी जान है और मेरी भी उसकी पहचान है।
Thank you. Yes sir, over to you.
Can I have the video please?
Hello everyone, my name is Dr. Prashant Chotalia. I am consultant rheumatologist working at rheumatology clinic Surat, Gujarat. I did my MBBS from Premier Medical College in 2008. After that I pursue my MD in general medicine from Government Medical College Surat. After completing my medicine, I joined in the same department as assistant professor where I worked for around 2.5 years. After that, I went on to pursue fellowship in rheumatology, which I did from NHN Medical College, Ahmedabad, under Dr. Sapan Pandey and Dr. Pooja Srivastava. And currently, I am working as consultant rheumatologist.
Good evening.
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन. आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स फॉर अलाउइंग मी टू डिलीवर अ लेक्चर विच इज ऑन अ टॉपिक विच इज वेरी कॉमन फॉर. ऑन द स्टार्ट ऑफ द प्रेजेंटेशन आई वुड लाइक टू आस्क हाउ मेनी ऑफ यू सिटिंग हियर हैव एक्सपीरियंस जॉइंट पेन इन योर लाइफ और करंटली हैविंग जॉइंट पेन. आई थिंक ऑलमोस्ट ऑल एंड मेनी ऑफ मे बी हैविंग जॉइंट पेन बिकॉज ऑफ लास्ट नाइट्स डांस ऑल्सो. So I will guide you through the journey how you can approach a patient with joint pain in some easy and simple steps. So the objective of today's presentation would be to learn, develop a systemic approach of patient presenting to you with joint pain and form a differential diagnosis, to provide overview of common investigations that need to be done and how to initially manage this patient before we can actually make a diagnosis. So in any patient with joint pain or rheumatology, there are two steps in making diagnosis that you can possibly have in your mind. One is to identify a particular syndrome. So presentation wise, you can have a generalized pain syndrome. You can have a regional pain, that means pain in a particular joint, other knee pain, joint pain, neck pain, back pain. Then articular syndrome, which is our heart in our rheumatology, because most of the patient comes for that issue. Then bone pain, low back or neck pain, systemic syndromes and muscle symptoms. So first, from the history, you have to identify your patient in which of this group your patient is falling in, and after that you can make a specific diagnosis. Now, how to characterize a musculoskeletal problem? So what are the symptoms? So common symptoms would be pain, swelling in the joint, stiffness, redness, restriction of movement of a particular joint. Then you have to identify what is the mode of onset and chronology. So what happened in most of our clinic is that when the patient comes to us, he directly says ki sir mujhe joint hai na 5 dino se dukh raha hai. So we don't ask them ki ye pehli bar ho raha hai ki nahi, sometimes because of our busy schedule also. But you need to ask ki whether this is the first time they are having, or they are having repeated episodes of this kind, or they are having a pain which is there for around 2-3 months and then suddenly after last 5 days it is increased. So the mode of onset, whether it was acute, subacute, chronic, and what was the chronology, whether it was continuously progressive, whether it is static as it is, or there are repeated episodes of flare and then revision. Then site and distribution of the symptoms. It is a particular joint issue or a periarticular, means whether the pain is arising from a structures which are outside joint, which include tendon or bursa or ligament. Then whether there are any associated symptoms preceding illness, injuries, red flags, or other relevant clues. This is particularly important in current scenario of COVID, because after COVID we have seen there are de novo onset of rheumatoid arthritis, there are flare of existing diseases, de novo onset of various CTDs as well as large vessel and small vessel vasculitis. So it is a kind of reactive phenomenon that similar to what we see in chikungunya arthritis. So always you have to ask what was the preceding symptoms, preceding history. Response to health intervention. So most of our patients of joint pain, they usually have multiple consultations, homeopathic, ayurvedic, allopathic, some over-the-counter medications. So you have to ask which treatment they have taken, whether there was any response to those treatments or not, and how the symptoms impact the quality of life in their day-to-day routine practice, because that is the most worrisome symptoms for patient. They don't want to know about diagnosis in detail, they don't want to know about detail of rheumatoid arthritis. What they want to know is whether this joint pain can be treated or not, and whether I'll be able to do my work or not. So the common thing is joint pain, and there are two things. One is arthralgia and one is arthritis. So it is a simple thing. Arthralgia is a kind of subjective phenomenon. It can be there with actual pathology, or it can be just a psychogenic or a subjective thing. So you don't get findings of inflammation in arthralgia, while in arthritis you will have objective evidence of inflammation in the form of redness, swelling or tenderness. Now, once you identify problem is related to joint among the 6 syndromes which we discussed, then you have to decide these certain parameters to reach to a diagnosis. Whether it is an acute or chronic condition, whether it is monoarticular, oligoarticular or polyarticular, whether it is articular, periarticular or a referred pain, whether it is inflammatory or non-inflammatory, whether it is symmetric or asymmetric, intermittent or additive, migratory or fleeting, and whether there are any associated systemic signs. So generally up to 6 weeks we call it acute or subacute, and after 6 weeks we call it chronic. So if I give you a classical example of acute, it would be chikungunya arthritis. So from the day one of fever, they generally start having polyarthritis, and it is sometimes so severe that patient is not able to move from the bed. And after that, in chronic, there are various like rheumatoid arthritis, psoriatic arthritis, or IBD-related arthritis, or other CT-derived connective tissue diseases. Mono means one, oligo means when you have a 1 to 5 joints are involved, and poly means more than 5 joints are involved. Now we will discuss rest of the parameter. First thing is to identify whether it is articular or periarticular, neurogenic or referred pain. So we will focus mainly on the articular and periarticular part. So if you see, in periarticular, the movements are restricted in a particular movement, not all the movements are restricted. Suppose I have a rotator cuff injury, so mainly I would have issue in abduction of the shoulder. I will not be having issue in interrotation if the joint is normal. But if I have a shoulder arthritis, then all the movement, adduction, abduction, extension, flexion, everything will be painful. So that is the first clue how you will differentiate whether it is periarticular or articular. Second, in pain in motion. So most of the time in periarticular, like tendinitis or bursitis, it is the active motion which are painful. While when you examine the patient, you can easily lift the shoulder because they don't require their own effort. While in articular, active as well as passive, both the movement are painful. Then range of motion. In pediarticular pain, particular movement of a joint which is affected by a involved ligament or a tendon will be restricted. While in the articular pain, all the active passive, all the range of movement will be restricted. Then other is the resistive active movement. So common condition which we see in our OPD is like tennis elbow or a golfer's elbow. So in that case, if you do a resistive flexion or extension of the wrist, then they will produce localized pain at the site of insertion of the common extensor or a flexor tendon. That is pain or resistive movement, which is not seen in patient with articular pain. Then tenderness on palpation. That is an important thing on examination. So in patient with periarticular pain, you have a tenderness which is slightly away from the joint, away from the joint line, and it is classically over the tendon. So in tennis elbow, you will have a tenderness over the lateral epicondylitis rather than the actual joint line of the elbow. So here you can see the black arrow which shows that that is the actual joint line of the elbow. So there is a swelling at the joint line, so it is an articular condition. While on the other photo, you can see the olecranon bursitis, which is slightly away from the actual joint line. That is a periarticular thing. Now, after that, another important thing is referred pain. Sometimes we often miss this, and we may end up in doing lot of investigations, and we find nothing. So on the figure, there are certain sites of referred pain. So myocardial pain, we all know that it radiates to our shoulder or arm. Then on the scapula, gallbladder pain or diaphragmatic involvement can have referred pain. Then referred pain of C1, C5 at the above the scapula and below the scapula. Then pain associated with pancreatitis, peptic ulcer or aortic aneurysm, that can radiate to back. Kidney pain can radiate to back. Then hip disease pain can radiate that. And the L2 pain can also radiate sometimes to the buttocks. Now, how you differentiate pain which is radiating to a particular joint and it is not actual joint? So there are few clues. One is that when you rub the site of referred pain, it will actually improve if it is a referred pain. So suppose your patient is having a hip arthritis issue, but he is also having pain at knee. So when you ask that patient to localize the pain, he will not localize that pain in the knee at a particular site, because he is confused, it is a referred pain. So he will roughly give you a large area that he is feeling pain. And when you rub that site, it will improve. While it actually, if it is pain which is originating from the knee joint, rubbing will actually worsen the pain, and patient can actually pinpoint ke mujhe yahan pe hi dard hota hai, not there. And on examination, when you examine, though patient is pointing towards the knee joint, your knee joint examination will be normal, while your hip joint examination will be abnormal. So whenever you encounter a regional pain, that is if patient is coming to you with a particular joint pain, you should remember to examine the joint above and joint below always, though the patient doesn't complain you of pain in that joint. Now comes another point, is how to differentiate between inflammatory and non-inflammatory pain. So in inflammatory and non-inflammatory, there are few clues on symptoms. In inflammatory pain, the morning stiffness is usually more than 30 minutes, while in non-inflammatory, it is less than 30 minutes. constitutional symptoms. So in inflammatory pain, your body generally develops an acute phase response, and that will result in low grade fever, malaise, tiredness, everything, which is not there in non-inflammatory. Then time of major discomfort. So in inflammatory, it is after prolonged inactivity. So what happens is that when you have rheumatoid arthritis, suppose, and you are resting for 4 to 5 hours, so there will be accumulation of synovial fluid in a particular joint. Because you are resting, the drainage will be less as compared when you are walking, and that's why it causes distension of the capsule, and the stretching of capsule will worsen your pain. But as you start moving, there will be increase in the lymphatic drainage and venous drainage, and that will drain away your excess synovial fluid, and your stiffness will improve. So that is a very good clinical indicator that patient is having inflammatory pain or non-inflammatory pain. Then on signs, inflammatory pain will have signs of inflammation, that is swelling, then tenderness, as well as sometimes redness, and you have other systemic signs also. While in non-inflammatory, generally you have a tenderness along the joint line, and you won't find a swelling or a redness or a bump on a non-inflammatory joint. Now, after you have decided whether it is acute, oligopoly, or it is inflammatory, then the pattern of joint. So if you closely look at these three homunculus figures, the red joints are the involved joints. So in first, you can see that the right elbow is involved, bilateral wrists are involved, and in both hands, MCPs are involved. And in the lower limb, knee, ankle, and MTPs are involved. So what is symmetric and what is asymmetric joint involvement? We have read in books that rheumatoid arthritis is associated with symmetric joint pain, joint involvement. So when you have same group of joint involved on both sides of the body, that is symmetric joint pain. It not necessarily be same MCP. Suppose I have one first MCP in right and second on left, then it is symmetrical. It does not necessarily we need to have a second MCP on both the sides. So that is symmetrical joint involvement. When you have a different group of joints involved on both sides of the body, then it is asymmetrical. So in the second figure, you can see that right wrist is involved and then left knee is involved. And the last figure is for the osteoarthritis, where the black color indicates the sites which are most commonly involved, and the gray indicates those sites which are less commonly involved. So by far the most common joint which are involved for osteoarthritis is the hip and knee. So whenever you find involvement of joint because of osteoarthritis in rare joints, always try to rule out secondary causes of osteoarthritis. That is existing inflammatory arthritis, be it rheumatoid arthritis or psoriatic arthritis, that can eventually damage the joint and cause the secondary osteoarthritis. So when you find osteoarthritis and atypical joint like in shoulder or in fingers, particularly the single finger, always try to rule out secondary OA, that is by ruling out the inflammatory arthritis. After that, there are few patterns of involvement. One is intermittent, in which you have episodes of either monoarthritis or polyarthritis with complete resolution of symptoms in between. This is classically we see in gout. कि पेशेंट को एक बार अटैक होता है देन ही रिस्पांस कर देता है आफ्टर 2-3 मंथ्स ही इज एब्सोल्युटली फाइन आफ्टर 2-3 मंथ्स अगेन देयर विल बी फ्लेयर ऑफ द डिजीज सिमिलरली देयर इज अ प्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ रूमेटॉइड आर्थराइटिस व्हिच इज नोन एज पैलिंड्रोमिक रूमेटिज्म मेनी आर अनअवेयर ऑफ दिस टर्मिनोलॉजी इन दैट पेशेंट जनरली हैव रिपीटेड एपिसोड्स ऑफ पेन आइदर इन वन जॉइंट और अ फ्यू जॉइंट एंड ऑन द डे ऑफ पेन द पेन इज सो सीवियर दैट पेशेंट इज नॉट एबल टू डू एनी एक्टिविटी But by the time he comes to you, and if he or she has taken the medicines, either NSAIDs or any other, they are so fine that we suspect them as fibromyalgia. So always rely on patient's history and ask this question. If patient in a middle-aged female having inflammatory episodes of joint pain in past, try to rule out palindromic rheumatism. Then other is migratory, which we use to mug up for the VIVA, that is the acute rheumatic fever, which generally have the migratory joint pain pattern. Similar pattern you can see in gonococcal arthritis also. And other is additive, that is classically which we see in rheumatoid arthritis. Now, apart from this small joint or large joint involvement, other things that we should keep in mind is involvement of the spine, especially the lower back and the neck, which is classically seen in spondyloarthritis, which include AS or reactive arthritis or psoriatic arthritis. So there are few pattern of back involvement also that we should keep in mind. So when you investigate a patient of back, the important thing you identify is the red flag signs. The red flags include history of fever, history of night pain, history of weight loss, history of malignancy, history of inflammatory back pain. That means when patient get up early in the morning, the stiffness in the back is more than 30 minutes. So these are the things that require a proper investigation. However, in 90 to 95% cases of backache, they are generally non-specific back pain and they don't require much investigation or an invasive or a harder treatments. And in around 80 to 85% of the cases, you won't be able to find a cause of back pain. So keep that in mind. Even if you do X-ray, MRI, CT, everything, blood investigation, in 80 to 85% of the cases, you won't be able to find a cause of back pain. So in that case, you just have to treat them with medical management and physiotherapy. Now, last point is, when you identify patient ki, okay, this is acute mono or poly or oligo symmetrical pattern of arthritis, inflammatory or non-inflammatory, then you have to rule out systemic symptoms. Sorry about this busy slide, but there are various symptoms that you can see in a patient of rheumatology. Every rheumatological disease is a multi-system disease and not restricted to the joint. So almost all the systems of the body are involved. I will show you some of the features of the patient which I have seen. So these are classical deformities of rheumatoid arthritis. In first figure, you can see the popping of the annular sphenoid, that is known as piano key styroid. In the second figure, you can see that swelling of the MCP joint as well as subluxation in the thumb, which is there, is known as Z deformity. In the lower figure, you have a zigzag hand, which is because of subluxation of MPP as well as ulnar deviation of the wrist joint. These are rheumatoid nodules. This is classical of psoriasis. If you can see in the first image, and I have put the image of two thumbs parallel, there was redness and swelling in the DIP of the thumb. In the second figure, you can see that in right hand, middle finger is swollen, that is known as dactylitis. So dactylitis is a swelling of joint itself as well as swelling of the joint of the tendons which are above and below the joint, that is flexor tendon tenosynovitis. In the lower figure, the types of psoriasis, one is behind ear, other is the plaque psoriasis, and other is the skull psoriasis. So if you suspect the patient to have a psoriasis, always actively look for behind ear, navel area, on the back, as well as on the frontal skull plane, because sometimes there may be hidden sites of psoriasis, patient themselves may not be aware of that. And studies have shown that patient who had nail psoriasis, that is only nail involvement, or skull psoriasis, or patient who are having flexural psoriasis, means generally psoriasis tends to occur on the extensor surface, but if patient have flexural psoriasis, means on the groin or elbow, those patients are more likely to develop psoriatic arthritis rather than classical extensor involvement psoriasis. So always look for these hidden sites. This is a patient of tophaceous gout. You can see tophi at multiple sites in the foot as well as in the finger. So generally most of the patients with gout have first attack in the first MP. But when they are uncontrolled on therapy, or when sometimes they use the urate lowering therapy without anti-inflammatory prophylaxis, your monoarticular gout will turn into polyarticular gout. So whenever you treat a patient of gout with uric acid lowering therapy, you should advise them to use NSAIDs or steroid prophylaxis depending upon indication to prevent the flare that can occur with urate lowering therapy. This is a rash of SLE. First figure is showing oral ulcer, then malar rash, then discoid rash, and subacute cutaneous lupus rash. In first two figures, you can see the parotid layer enlargement and the leg showing the gamma globulinic purpura of patient with Sjögren's syndrome. These are patients who came with active raters to the OPD. This is salt and pepper appearance of systemic sclerosis. And in the second figure, you can see that depression in the big digital fingertip, that is pitted ulcer. So if your patient is having this pitted ulcer and no other symptoms, still these patients have limited systemic sclerosis, you should investigate them and treat them. These are telangiectasia. Again, telangiectasia, tightness of skin over face, and severe contractures of the finger with trophic ulcers. In first figure, you can see the mechanic's hand. So when we see this kind of patient, the patient always says that he's
serving.
So that is not the thing. We have to collectively see the patient how he is presenting. These are calcinosis cutis. If you can see on the tip of the finger in the first and on the sheen of the tibia. This is paniculitis, which is known as erythema nodosum. These are classical rashes of dermatomyositis, Quatrain's sign, Quatrain's papule, heliotrope rash, as well as Scholl's sign. This is polychondritis. And second one is saddle nose deformity because of vaginous granulomatosis. And last photo is of scleritis. So you can see that rheumatologist, as a rheumatologist, we see all the systemic involvement. Sometimes patient comes only with scleritis. They have high titer of rheumatoid factor or anti-CCP positivity. So we treat them with immunosuppression if it is severe or recurrent. Now once you have used those step-wise approach, you can have these four presentation: active inflammatory or non-inflammatory arthritis, similarly chronic inflammatory or non-inflammatory arthritis. So If you don't remember everything, remember this thing. If your patient comes to you with predominant joint symptoms and mild systemic symptoms, it is predominantly arthritis spectrum of disease. If your patient comes to a lot of systemic symptoms and few joint symptoms, it is basically CTD or vasculitis. These are the causes of polyarticular joint pain, inflammatory and non-inflammatory. Because of time constraint, I won't go in detail. These are some of the causes of monoarticular joint pain. Now, routine investigation. We generally do routine investigation, CBC, RFT, LFT, urine and acute phase response, imaging, X-ray, USG, CT scan and MRI. I just want to highlight, USG is coming in a big way for rheumatology. Now most of the rheumatology centers train the rheumatologists themselves to do the USG. So that will help in diagnosis as well as interventions like intra-articular injections. And special investigation includes synovial fluid examination, rheumatoid factor, anti-CCP, ANA profile, myositis-specific antibodies coming in long way for inflammatory myositis and complementary. Pointer is not. So this is a slide about inflammatory markers. The important thing is CRP is better than ESR as of now because there are certain limitations with ESR. It will be affected by the shape of RBCs, anemia, polycythemia, some non-specific elevation of protein also. These are the causes of CRP elevation. I just want to highlight this figure that when you have a high titer elevation of CRP, it is most commonly seen with adult onset Still's disease or vasculitis. Moderate level can be seen in spondylitis. In SLE patient, you generally don't see high CRP unless and until patient is having first infection, second serositis, or third active arthritis. Then rheumatoid factor and anti-CCP. Anti-CCP has more specificity at the same level of sensitivity with rheumatoid factor. Both have sensitivity of around 70-80%, but the specificity of anti-CCP is around 90-95%. So if you want to confirm it, better to go with anti-CCP rather than rheumatoid factor. There are various non-rheumatological causes of high rheumatoid factor elevation. You can see that old age, bacterial endocarditis, liver disease, TB, syphilis, parasite, leprosy, viral disease, and sarcoidosis. A whole bunch of causes that can cause elevation of the rheumatoid factor. So don't always make a diagnosis of rheumatoid arthritis based on just rheumatoid factor elevation. This is something regarding ANA. So slide showing indirect immunofluorescence in which you have a microscope slide which is tagged with the F2 cells. You add the serum and then you add a fluorescent labeled anti-human immunoglobulin and you make an antigen-antibody complex which can give you a fluorescent pattern. These are the few patterns. First is the homogeneous, second is the centromere, which is classically seen in limited cutaneous systemic sclerosis, and third would be speckled. These are the causes which are seen classically in different types of pattern. I won't go in detail. But this thing I want to highlight. When you order ANA, don't rely everything on ANA until your patient is having symptoms. So if you can see that the sensitivity of ANA is more than 90% in most of the cases, but specificity is around 50-60%. So it is sensitive to rule out, if you suspect CTD, it is good to do ANA by IF to rule out SLE. But if you don't have a classical symptom, don't do ANA unnecessarily because you yourself will be misguided that patient is having CTD. Then synovial fluid examination, that is the next step. And the photo is important. So when you do a synovial fluid tap, you just do this string test. If the string is formed with more than 5 centimeters without break, it is generally normal viscosity. But if you have a low viscosity, which is classically seen in inflammation or in infection, you will have decreased viscosity. In that case, you can subject the synovial fluid for culture as well as gram stain. There is no need to do LDH or glucose for synovial fluid examination. The important thing is to look for crystal, look for gram stain, and do the culture. This is an approach. You can see that first you have to look whether it is inflammatory or non-inflammatory. So if you have an inflammatory, then you have to see whether it is polyarticular or oligoarticular. Whether there is great involvement of hand, wrist and joint, then it is most likely going towards RA. If patient is having poly, oligo or monoarticular associated with various systemic symptoms like malar rash, oral ulcer, photosensitivity, it is going towards CTD. If you have a more involvement of lower limb joint, then it is most likely going towards spondyloarthritis. Now, if you don't have any inflammatory component, and then it is going most towards osteoarthritis or other non-inflammatory causes. This is a simple algorithm, how to initially treat, which involve pharmacologic and non-pharmacological measures. So, if you don't look at slide and don't want to remember, just remember that don't use steroid without diagnosis, because when you use steroid, it will hide everything, whether it is tumor, whether it is CTD, whether it is inflammatory arthritis, everything will be hidden. You won't be able to make diagnosis. So use steroid only after you make a diagnosis that this patient has a particular disease. I have two cases, but we'll skip that. So the key points are, give more time in talking to the patient and listening. In rheumatology, most of the diagnosis is made with history and physical examination. Investigations we generally use to confirm the findings and to look whether the patient is having good or bad prognosis. Rheumatoid factor positive does not mean RA, as I have showed that there are various causes of high rheumatoid factor. No ASO in adults. I have seen many patients coming with ASO reports that at the 30-45 years of age, they have ASO being done. So generally, acute rheumatic fever we see up to 15 years of age, so there is no need of doing ASO after that. No uric acid in premenopausal women. This is also a common mistake that is basically done by orthopedic. They generally investigate when patient comes to joint pain to uric acid. So in premenopausal woman, because estrogen is uricosuric, you generally don't get hyperuricemia unless and until patient is having some other issues like chronic kidney disease or some other medications which is causing high uric acid, like anti-tubercular drug. So don't do uric acid evaluation unless and until you are sure from the clinical history that patient had attack of gout. ANA only in clinical suspiciousness of CTD. Always look for joint plus symptoms. Try to identify the pattern of joint involvement. Give symptomatic treatment till you make the diagnosis. Avoid giving corticosteroid unnecessary. And early referral to rheumatologist whenever you feel necessary, because time is money for joint also. When you delay the diagnosis and onset of treatment, patient may lose a few joints that will not function for life. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
And sorry, I overshoot the time.
Okay, any questions for sir?
Yes. Sir. Sir, I will ask one question.
Yes.
Sir, in gout, which investigation we should advise immediately? Because sometimes uric acid is normal, starting. And how to treat the gout patients?
Yes, sir. So, diagnosis of gout is basically made on clinical suspicions, and by the time patient comes to you, the gout episode may have resolved. So, the ideal case would be to look for the crystals in the synovial fluid, which is usually not possible in our scenario. So, by just taking the history and examination without looking at the uric acid, if you suspect it is gout, you just can treat the patient. The newer modality which is come is dual CT, dual energy CT, DECT, that can easily identify the asymptomatic profile deposition also. But it is in an upcoming way and it is also costly. So sir, for confirmation it is the crystals, otherwise you have to rely on clinical history and examination.
First give NSAID, not give the colchicine.
So the choice of drug for acute attack depends upon the comorbid condition, because gout attacks mostly occur in old age patients who have CKD or some other comorbid condition, in which case colchicine may be slightly hazardous. So generally, whenever there is borderline raised creatinine or high creatinine, I use a low dose steroid 30 to 40 milligram and then taper rapidly on 2 to 4 weeks depending upon the response. But if patient doesn't have any comorbid condition or the creatinine function is normal, then you can use both of them, either colchicine or NSAIDs. And other thing I would like to add is, initially in older days, high dose colchicine was used. Nowadays, we generally use up to 1.5 milligram, three doses of 0.5 milligram tablets, that is okay.
And when should we give the antenal inhibitor?
So, guideline for starting the ureteroid therapy is, absolute indication would be more than 2 attacks per year of gout, or you have a tophaceous gout, or on X-ray you demonstrate that typical damage is caused by the gout. And conditional recommendation, if you have only one attack of gout, but still you have a CKD of stage 3 or 4, or you have history of uric acid stone, or your uric acid with one attack is more than 6 mg per deciliter, those are the indications to start urate-lowering therapy. And once you start urate-lowering therapy, it is generally lifelong. It is not like ki aapka uric acid normal ho gaya, you stop. You should continue, because trials have demonstrated that those patients who stop uric acid lowering therapy, they tend to have higher rates of flare.
80, then taper or start with 40, then increase?
Start with low dose and then increase, because in Han Chinese, which are our neighbors, they have demonstrated that deficiency of a particular HLA type, which is associated with allopurinol hypersensitivity, though it is seen in less than 1%, but it can be devastating. So start with low dose and go up to higher dose. So, can I ask one question to audience? what is the maximum dose of allopurinol any of you have used for gout? 300. So you can go up to 800 milligram before switching to febuxostat. That's what I want to tell. Because in trial they have compared febuxostat with 300 milligram only, but when your patient permits, you can go up to 800 milligram.
So febuxostat will be first choice.
Both are equal, sir. There are two trials which have.
Found it much more effective. Febuxostat.
Yeah, febuxostat much more effective. It is also associated with higher rates of flare. So you can use both of them, but I would use allopurinol first. So initially, sprouts and kathod nahi khavana evu keta tha Gujarati ma me. But the recent recommendation is you can allow the sprouts also. The only thing you need to cut down is meat protein, dairy products a little bit, and mainly the if they are having alcohol intake, you should reduce the alcohol intake, and the canned juices and canned sauce like ketchups and the canned juice, they should be avoided because that contain fructose and that have shown to increase the flare rates or the uric acid. Sorry, sir?
Leafy vegetables, yes.
That you can take, sir. The drug induced in case, especially with when you are having thiazide, you can switch to losartan because losartan has uricosuric action. Then you can withhold for some time if it is very high, sir.
Sir, role of hyaluronidase and collagen in OA knee joint.
Sorry, sir?
Role of hyaluronidase injection and collagen in osteoarthritis of the knee joint.
Sir, it is not recommended by the guideline, American Board of Rheumatology.
But people are giving.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. A big round of applause for our last speaker for the day. Thank you.
I request our moderator to please facilitate the speaker. Dr. Prashant, with a small token of reverence from VMA. Please, a big round of applause. And to felicitate our moderator, I request our MediMeet co-convener, Dr. Alpa Mehta Ma'am, to please come on us.
Of the conference, two or three minor things are left.